So, a short while ago, SSL released a version of their most iconic product in history, which is the SSL Bus Compressor. And this came in the form of the SSL Bus Plus. SSL have taken the Bus Plus, and they've not just given us a bus compressor. This thing has a lot of bells and whistles. We're talking dynamic EQs, several different modes. It can do stereo, dual mono, mid-side, and it even has a 4K mode. But my biggest question is, how does it stack up to the Smart Research C2? Now, I've been a C2 user for many years now, and I've heard from a few people that they've sold their C2 in exchange for the Bus Plus. Now, that to me just sounds like
fake news,
but I'm always on the path to make noise great again. So thanks to Sam at Make Noise Pro Audio, we have today a Bus Plus available, and I'm going to go through everything it offers, the good, the bad, the ugly. Let's figure it out and take a look at what this has to offer. Let's jump right in. Okay, so if we're starting from top to bottom, the first button we have here is the low THD button. Now, what this button does is reduce the amount of distortion that's imparted onto lower range frequencies. So if you're working on hip hop, house, dance, anything like that, and you've got quite a lot of low end, then this is an excellent button to use. The next button, that right there, is feedback mode. So typically the SSL compressor would be a feed forward design, which is what gives it its grabby character. To put it into feedback mode turns this into basically a completely different unit, and it makes it a lot smoother and a lot more transparent. So if you're working on softer styles of music and you need a much more musical sounding compressor, this is the button for you. Now you'll notice that there's some writing above the 4K mode. So the next button across is 4K mode, which turns this compressor more into your classic SSL 4K bus compressor. The button above it says set distortion. This button makes the SSL bus comp very, very gritty and quite distorted. However, if you long press this button, it'll begin flashing. You can then use the low THD and feedback button to dial in the amount of distortion that you want. And as you can see, the LED changes colour depending on how light or how aggressive you want it. And then you long press again to get out of it. Very interesting. And we'll hear what that sounds like in a little bit. The dynamic EQ section I'm going to leave out for a moment while we talk about the general controls. So here we have threshold, attack, makeup, a variable sidechain high pass filter. We've got ratio, release, a built-in mix knob, and then also low frequency gain. Ratios, you've got some crazy ratios available. You've got everything from 1.3 to 1, all the way up to 20 to 1, and they've also added some negative ratios, so you've got negative 2.5, negative 1.5, or negative 0.5. Negative ratios would generally be used for special effects sounding things. You can do some crazy stuff with negative ratios. High pass goes all the way from out, which is 0, all the way up to 300 Hz. And anything in between, so you can set that however you like. On the attack settings, we've got everything from 0.1 all the way up to 40 milliseconds. And on release, you've got 0.5 all the way up to 1.2. You also have two different auto settings. So at the moment, for my general bus compression duties, I've got the threshold on plus 4, the attack on 10, makeup gain is around 0, then I've got ratio at 4 to 1, auto release, fully wet. Now, SSL's implementation of this compressor is really quite clever. So, it's an analog unit, right? It's fully analog. However, It does have a digital microcontroller on the inside. So all the buttons on the front are actually controlling a digital card, which then sets the internal values. However, the whole signal path is analog. What this basically means is this unit's completely invulnerable to pot tolerances, because when the pots are being turned, they correspond to digital values. So over time, as pots would generally slip, that doesn't matter. This to me is really clever, because it keeps the signal flow analog, but it means that recallability and reliability are both way, way, way easier and way higher. So this is great. Also, there's a bunch of, don't want to say hidden features, but hidden features that on a surface level you may miss. The other good thing about it is all the pots are stepped, all of them. So that's fantastic. Makes, again, recallability so much easier, and it makes balancing the left and right sides in dual mono much easier. That's something that I wish the C2 had. The threshold particularly on the C2 is continually variable, so sometimes it's a bit of a pain trying to get the left and right to be exact. Let's jump in closer to the device and I'll talk you through what everything does. Okay, so the push button setup, the first one that is available is on makeup gain. Now, if you push that, that then puts the dynamic EQ post-compression. So you can move where the dynamic EQ comes into the chain, pre or post-compressor. If you long press this button, you will see that fine is illuminated. This gives you fine control of the makeup gain, so that you can really, really very closely match the left and right together. The external side chain is also a push button. Now, this text here says comp dynamic EQ. Now, what this means is if you push the button once, it's now controlling the side chain of the compressor. Now it's controlling the side chain of the dynamic EQ, and now it's doing both. So those are your available options there with the side chain. All right, moving down, the first black knob is the low frequency gain. This can be affected positively or negatively to reduce or lower the gain. Now, this is also a push button, and what you will see is G-series. So if you push it, it's now a G-series low-end EQ. And if you leave it out, it's an E-series. Okay, looking at the dynamic EQ. So you also have positive and negative dynamic EQ. This works in the very similar way to a plugin like, let's say, FabFilter Pro Q3, where you can set the bands to be dynamic. This works in exactly the same way. As you can see, we have LED lights which show you how much or how little is being applied to the dynamic EQ, and they light up from green to orange. Now the high band, which is a shelf by its default status, can actually be turned into a bell using this button. Okay, so to talk you through the middle and lower buttons here, you've got high frequency fast, low frequency fast. Now the normal attack and release times for these are 3 milliseconds attack, 50 milliseconds release. However, if the fast buttons are pressed, this changes it to a 1 millisecond attack and a 50 millisecond release. Now there's also a third mode. What this does, if you hold the button in, it will go pink. And what that indicates is you're now on the third mode, which is a 10 millisecond attack and an auto release. Now the question is, how do you go about changing the low frequency and high frequency on the dynamic EQ? Well, the answer is simple. You simply press and hold the button, and as you can see, the meters now change. The way you adjust this is with the low frequency and high frequency fast buttons. Up and down. And as you can see, the VU meter changes to correlate what they are. Now, to give you an idea, there are 15 points on each, and the low frequency goes all the way from 20 Hz all the way up to 170 Hz, and the high frequency goes from 2K all the way up to 17K as a shelf, and as a bell, you've got 0.7 up to 16. Now, if you want to see some graphs, charts, all that kind of thing, All of that is available in the manual. To exit this mode, you hold down the button again and everything returns to normal. Also worth noting, when in this mode, the right-hand side, as you can see, is different to this. The right-hand side indicates the range that the dynamic EQ will affect. Now, there are again multiple positions between 0.5 and 8 dB. The steps are all in 0.5 increments. Again, the full chart is available in the manual. Now, in terms of the top buttons, each channel can be turned on and off independently, and then you've got the mode button. So I'm currently using this in dual mono to match what I do with the C2. Obviously in dual mono, each side is controlled independently. It will also do mid-side mode, which is the left side controls the mid, the right side controls the side. You've also got classic stereo, and when in classic stereo, the right-hand side is disabled and everything is controlled from the left. And then you've also finally got sigma sidechain stereo, which puts more emphasis on the mid-band, I believe. We'll go back to dual mono though, because that's how I'm using it with the C2. Now the C2 can also be run in dual mono or stereo, but in practice I found that I always prefer dual mono because it enhances the stereo image and makes things sound bigger, wider, and just more exciting. So I'll leave the Bus Plus in dual mono for the shootout. Gotta learn to trust yourself. Gotta do what you gotta do, little man. Listen up, learn to trust yourself. Gotta do what you gotta do, little miss sunshine. Learn to trust yourself. Gotta do what you gotta do. Better listen up, learn to trust yourself. And eventually find a way. Straight up, I'm gonna miss this. With my missus headed abroad to a country out of nowhere that the means to record. But I'ma seek it out. Trap in the force, referring to the source that y'all been whipping up in the studio. It's not about the what, but more so who you know. Looking forward to linking up with you at the show. Life is all about people, the way you make them feel. The impression that you leave them with before you go. Here's my word of advice, you better treat them right. Everybody has potential, seen it in their eyes. Be they got if they lacking the motivation. Don't quit on a brother and practice having some patience. I've been waiting for a minute, now I'm back. Gotta learn to trust yourself. Gotta do what you gotta do, little man. Listen up, learn to trust yourself. Gotta do what you gotta do, little miss sunshine. Learn to trust yourself. Gotta do what you gotta do. Better listen up, learn to trust yourself. And eventually find a way. Straight up, I'm gonna miss this. With my missus headed abroad to a country out of nowhere that the means to record. But I'ma seek it out. Driving the force, referring to the source that y'all been whipping up in the studio. It's not about the what, but more so who you know. Looking forward to linking up with you at the show. Life is all about people, the way you make them feel. The impression that you leave them with before you go. Here's my word of advice, you better treat them right. Everybody has potential, seen it in their eyes. Be they got if they lacking the motivation. Don't quit on a brother and practice having some patience. I've been waiting for a minute, now I'm back on. 5 years later, goddamn, it took me that long to write wrongs and to put them in a song. You gotta learn to trust yourself.
There's nothing better than a moment with you.
All right, let's bounce these between each other, the SSL and the C2. All right, so I guess that's the SSL Bus Plus. If I had to give an opinion on it, I think as a device, I think it's really, really nice. I think it offers a lot of great features and it's really usable. And it has that SSL sound, which you would expect, given the fact it's from SSL, right? The 4K compressor mode is really nice. However, for me, in my use case, I don't think apples to apples as a bus compressor, it beats the C2. In the audio examples, to me, the C2 sounded fuller, it sounded a bit more hi-fi, and it just glued a little bit more. The SSL almost sounded a little, I don't really want to say it, but a little thin. It sounded a little just less. It had the character and the punch and the attack and that kind of thing, but the C2 just lifted the mix and it sounded amazing, whereas the SSL just lifted it a little or not as much. However, I'm not saying that that means the SSL Bus Plus is a bad investment or a bad product. It's not. For the utility it offers, the dynamic EQ, all the different compression modes, the mid-side, it's a really, really useful device to have around. And I guess I'm spoiled in the fact that I have a C2 and some pull techs and things like that. And so for me, it was always going to be a tall order for the SSL to beat all of that different gear in a single device. But I think it does a valiant job. And I think it really does have a place in most studios. If you're the kind of person who is just getting into outboard, or you're looking for a bit of a Swiss Army knife bus tool, this is a great choice. It will offer you a lot of bang for buck. I think it's a really sound investment, especially considering the price SSL are charging for it. I think it runs about $1,300, something like that. As always, these are available from Sam at Make Noise Pro Audio. Thanks again, Sam, for sending this one over for the purposes of this review, and I will leave a link below to the Make Noise website, where you can shop his array of boutique gear, and he has got some real corkers on there at the moment. Thanks a lot for watching, and if you've made it this far, congrats. I appreciate it. Feel free to, you know, super thanks or whatever. That would be absolutely appreciated. Until we meet each other again, take care of yourselves and be well.